is CNN breaking news.
Hello and welcome to our viewers in the United States and around the world. I'm Aisha Sasay.
And I'm John Vores. We're live in Los Angeles. It has just gone 10 o'clock here, Thursday night on the West Coast. Thank you for being with us.
And we're following two major stories for you. That special election in the state of Montana, just one day after the Republican frontrunner allegedly body slammed a reporter.
The other major headline, the president's son-in-law, Jared Kushner, now a focus of the FBI investigation into the Trump campaign's ties to Russia. A lot more on that major development this hour.
But first, let's get to Montana, where CNN project Republican Greg Gianforte will win a seat in the U.S. House of Representatives. Gianforte with 50.4% of the vote, Democrat Rob Quest with 43.8%. We have about 84% of the vote counted.
Gianforte was the overwhelming favorite before his confrontation with a reporter from the Guardian newspaper on Wednesday. Gianforte apologized during his victory speech just a few moments ago, but the newly elected congressman has actually been charged with a misdemeanor assault.
Well, joining us now here in L.A., senior reporter for media and politics Dylan Byers and CNN political reporter Maeve Rustin.
Also, former Los Angeles City Councilwoman Wendy Gruhl and CNN political commentator and Trump supporter John Phillips.
And from Missoula, Montana, Gwen Florio is the city editor for the Missoulian. And finally, criminal defense attorney and former prosecutor Troy Slayton is here in L.A. We have a very full house here. Let's get to our guest there in Missoula and get your reaction to this win. Are you surprised that Gianforte pulled it out of the bag?
Not particularly. He had been a heavy favorite going into this. This just happened last night, and by the time this happened, about half the people in Montana had already cast their votes by mail.
Okay, well, with that in mind, we did hear that apology from Gianforte. Let's listen to exactly what he said, because, you know, it seemed very sincere, it seemed very heartfelt. Let's listen to Mr. Gianforte.
Last night I made a mistake. And I took an action that I can't take back, and I'm not proud of what happened. I should not have responded in the way that I did, and for that I'm sorry.
And you're forgiven. Please.
I should not have treated that reporter that way, and for that I'm sorry, Mr. Ben Jacobs.
So, Gwen, just very quickly, back to you there in Montana. We heard someone yell out from the crowd, "You are forgiven." Will he be forgiven?
It seems like his constituency already is. That got the bigger cheer than what he was saying.
Yeah. John Phillips, to you, the Republican, he won the race. I mean, listen, he got the win, but let's look at the margins here. Was it as impressive as you expected it to be?
Well, the last public poll showed him up by 14 points. That was a Gravis poll that was done in May. He ended up winning by, what, 6 or 7 points as the tally stands right now. It's a state where Trump's popularity is actually higher than his. He had a lot of baggage going into this election, but this was an election that the Democrats focused on, not just Democrats in Montana, but Democrats nationwide dumped a ton of money into this race. And they've been having these huge crowds show up at all of these events in these congressional districts when these Congress members go back and they say, look at this, these rallies, look at the size of these audiences. They're going to clean their clocks as soon as they get to the ballot box. Well, we've had a race in Kansas. We've had a race in Louisiana. We've had a special election in Montana, and the Democrats haven't won one yet. At some point, they're going to have to show that they could win electorally. Otherwise, it's just a lot of noise and a lot of screaming and a lot of being rude to congressmen.
I just want to say on the apology, just for a moment, we'll get back to the politics and what this all actually means. Maeve, to you, the apology from Gianforte, does that now mean this is all over?
No, I don't think so. I mean, it seemed heartfelt and sincere in the moment, and you know, I think that what he was doing there was trying to move on so that he is not, you know, a pariah when he arrives in Washington. There was a discussion going on, you know, Paul Ryan, for example, was asked repeatedly in his press conferences whether or not Gianforte should be seated if he won tonight. So clearly he's trying to get beyond that. It'll be interesting to see what happens with the actual charges that we're discussing here, the misdemeanor assault charge, and whether the case actually goes forward and whether that's something that he has to deal with. But, you know, we could very well be looking at a rematch again between these two guys. And it's just a very fluid situation right now. So I don't think that that statement put it to bed by any stretch.
I would respectfully disagree. I think that the look, this issue will live on in a way, and certainly it will be tied to his reputation. There are a lot of congressmen in Washington. He will be known as the guy who body slammed a reporter. But that was a full-throated apology. And it was comprehensive. He even said Ben Jacobs' name.
Right.
That's big. Certainly in terms of the sort of media firestorm that has existed around this issue for the last 24 hours, that puts it to bed. He won. He apologized. He's moving to Washington.
But he still has to go to court.
He's still, right. And so this, and so half disagree, because he might still have to go to court. And now, at least in the sort of realm of public opinion and how this shapes out, the ball, oddly enough, might be in Ben Jacobs' court. And the question is, do you continue to pursue charges? So we'll have to wait and see.
And, you know, everyone makes a mistake. Ben Jacobs himself threatened to punch a 16-year-old at CPAC in writing on Twitter. So if anyone knows that sometimes you can lose your temper and do and say things that you regret later, it's him.
I don't know.
I would just respectfully, and I'm not familiar with the tweet, I would say there's a difference between an errant and an irresponsible tweet and actually grabbing a guy with two hands by the neck.
Yeah, there does seem to be a big gulf between those two.
And I don't think it is going to go away. I mean, again, he made major progress today by apologizing. But remember, Congress members run every 2 years. And this, you know, this seat is going to be another one that the Democrats are going to continue to focus on. And they may not win that first time, but they'll win that second time. And when you look at the numbers, there is a good chance. And the Democrats are organizing and getting people excited about taking back the House. Which, you know, hitting him the first time doesn't say to and that he won doesn't mean Democrats are going to sit back. Oh, we're not going to go after it. They're going to go after with greater vengeance, because they believe that's not the kind of person they want in Congress, who uses physical violence. Whether you apply or not, that is something that he did that caused that violence.
And Wendy's point is so important, because we are looking at, you know, a tapestry of races across the country in 2018, where, you know, you are going to have 20-something seats that determine the control of the House. And the question is, you know, whether Republicans are going to have, you know, the firepower to deal with a candidate like this, you know, on the side, when there's now questions about his temperament and, you know, going forward. Things like that.
So that makes me ask the question, when he gets to Washington, will he be embraced by fellow Republicans, or will they keep him at arm's length, given this history? John?
It depends on how he acts. There was the guy who shouted, "You lie," during President Obama's State of the Union, and he was kind of persona non grata for a little while. So I think they're going to fill him out and see what's going on. Now, I will say that this is an open seat where you don't have an incumbent running for re-election, and a lot of the seats that the Democrats are targeting, you're not going to find people who are unseasoned politicians, who are rookies, who are out there making these types of mistakes. Mimi Walters is not going to do this. Dana Rohrabacher is not going to do this. It's going to be much harder to mount credible campaigns against those candidates than this guy, and they lost here.
You know, within, you know, an hour of the altercation between Jacobs and Gianforte, the Democrats had already cut a campaign ad. They had it out on the internet. Let's listen to part of one of those ads.
Yesterday, a reporter asked Greg Gianforte about the new health care bill in Congress, and Gianforte came unhinged.
I'm sick and tired of you guys. The last time you came in here, you did the same thing. Get the hell out of here.
Fox News reporters who witnessed the attack say Gianforte grabbed the victim by the neck and slammed him to the ground. Hours later, the local sheriff charged Gianforte with assault.
You know, Wendy, that's a pretty powerful ad. Was it just too late? Had too many people already voted?
You know, when you saw that so many people had already voted, and as noted, Maeve mentioned earlier, people went to try to even change their vote and were told they couldn't do that in Montana. So I think it was late. But they're setting the groundwork for what's going to happen in 2018 to be able to run against this guy again. Because if it has happened, if it's happened before, it could happen again. And if you can't handle a reporter asking you questions, how can you handle your congress member next to you, your colleague, who's going to take you on certain issues they feel very passionate about? How are you going to do it with constituents who will yell at you? I mean, this is something that, you know, is very serious.
Okay, we're standing by for Rob Quist to speak. You see him on the screen there. In fact, let's listen in.
Explains to night. You know, we had, I think just today, we set some amazing records. There were, today alone, there were 1,123 people knocking on doors in the state of Montana. You know, I think one thing we can say is that your voices were definitely heard in this election. You know, it's just been such a great honor to be running for your representative in this race. And, you know, I know we came up short, but the energy in the state and the grassroots movement in the state goes on. It goes on. I've called Greg Gianforte and congratulated him on his victory, and I talked to him about how important it is to continue to reach out to all Montanans and listen to their comments, and I know that Montanans will hold Mr. Gianforte accountable. You know, traveling across the state, I have seen such great energy and enthusiasm like never before in this state. It's just been such a great thing to see. And, you know, to all the Montanans and the people across this country who took time to volunteer and to make calls and to engage for the very first time in this in an election, don't be discouraged. Be determined. You know, I've met so many of you along the way who've never been involved in politics before and stepped up for the very first time. And so I'm just saying that you must continue to be involved. You must continue. And in the coming months, there'll be a critical legislation that's going to be passed that will affect thousands.
Rob Quist there giving, I guess, effectively a concession speech there. He's already called Greg Gianforte to congratulate him for his win in that special election there in Montana. But, you know, he seems to be taking it in good stead, you know, thanking all those who participated and talking about the energy that was unleashed from this race. But also, interestingly enough, saying if you're pinning your hopes on him, you know, and obviously it didn't work out, don't be discouraged, be determined. That's his message to those who will be disappointed on this evening with the Republican winning that race in Montana.
And Dylan, to you, don't be discouraged, be determined. That's going to wear a little thin after a while, isn't it?
It is going to wear a little thin. And to go back sort of to, you know, what happens 2 years from now, 2 years is a very long time. I would never underestimate the sort of attention deficit disorder of the news cycle, which is, you know, he won having, you know, Gianforte won after having assaulted a reporter. Obviously, it was in the last minute. That might have affected things. I really think that this is in the past. Now it's a question of how he proves himself in Washington. Those are going to, what he does in Washington, those will be the campaign ads. Obviously, if he assaults another reporter in Washington, we've got new campaign ads to run. But again, I think this issue is put to bed now. I think the onus is on the Democrats to think about what kind of candidates they want to put forward. Quist, judging by that, seems like a very nice guy, and looks like nice guys finish last.
The folk singing cowboy, yeah. I mean,
not necessarily the strongest candidate that they could have had, and right. I think that...
And maybe because they didn't think they could win it either. I mean,
right, know, right. But I think that, you know, when thinking about this issue going forward, what'll be interesting to see is whether or not, you know, the argument that Nancy Pelosi tries to make, that this is a Trump-like candidate, that, you know, the Trump movement has spawned all of these kind of, you know, chest-thumping candidates who might tackle a reporter, and whether or not that's the kind of representation people want in Washington. That's a Nancy Pelosi argument, but if Democrats are successful in making that argument, that will have an impact in the midterms next year.
Okay, we'll take a short break. And of course, we should note that Gianforte won this election despite President Trump's record low approval numbers and all of these investigations which are currently ongoing into his campaign's collusion, alleged collusion with Russia. Yeah, but you know, these were issues that the Democrats were hoping may have played into this special election, but they did not. But there has been a significant development on the Russia investigation. Donald Trump's son-in-law and close advisor, Jared Kushner, now being looked at by the FBI as it looks at Russia's involvement in the presidential election. A lot more on those details after the break.
Plus, President Trump meets his NATO allies, and the result is peculiar. An uncomfortable NATO summit later this hour.
19 minutes past 10 here in Los Angeles. You're watching CNN Newsroom live from Los Angeles. I'm John Paul.
And I'm Aisha Sasay. Just 24 hours ago, he was being charged with assault for allegedly body slamming a reporter. Now Republican Greg Gianforte is projected to win the vacant U.S. House seat from Montana.
Let's take a look at the latest numbers. Gianforte has 50.4% of the vote. Democrat Rob Quist, 53.8%. 84% of the vote has now been counted.
All right, it's another big story that we're following for you. U.S. officials tell CNN that Jared Kushner, a senior advisor to President Trump, is under scrutiny by the FBI.
That means the investigation into Russian election meddling has now reached into the president's inner circle. Kushner is Mr. Trump's son-in-law. It's important to note, though, Jared Kushner has not been accused of any wrongdoing. Well, for more on this, we're joined once again by CNN's senior reporter for media and politics, Dylan Byers, CNN political reporter, Maeve Reston. We also have criminal defense attorney and former prosecutor, Troy Slayton, standing by. Troy, thank you for staying with us. Maeve, let's just look at some of the details of exactly what the FBI is looking at here. Why are they particularly interested in Kushner?
Well, we've known for some time about these two meetings that he had with Russian officials earlier on, but what we are learning today is that the focus has expanded where they're looking at Kushner's role in the Trump campaign's data analytics operation, which was run out of Texas, and his relationship with former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn, and also his contacts with Russians generally. As you said at the beginning, obviously he is not, at the moment that we know of, a target of the investigation. There's been no allegation of wrongdoing here. But these are the things that the FBI is looking at. And it puts the White House in a very difficult position because Jared Kushner, not only is he one of the closest people to the president and is with the president at all times, but he has a huge portfolio in the White House, just as he did during the campaign. And it's going to be a huge distraction going forward. And he is one of the people, he's overseeing that office of, you know, strategic innovations that they have. A lot of their big policy initiatives that they're excited about, Trump had tapped Kushner to lead. And so it really is just another cloud over a family member for Trump, which is just going to make him, you know, more angry about this investigation, which he believes is a hoax.
Yeah, let's go to Troy. Troy, legally speaking, how problematic is this for Jared Kushner?
I don't think it is very problematic, Aisha, and then here's the reason why. I fall in the same school as Alan Dershowitz, who here on CNN explained that as a civil libertarian, we have to look at federal investigations, federal prosecutions, FBI probes, now the investigation by the special counsel, Bob Mueller, as something looking into violations of federal law. Now, even if Jared Kushner was, or other members of the Trump campaign, transition team, or administration were talking to Russians, even coordinating with the Russians with regard to potential release of information, release of emails that were hacked into by WikiLeaks or the Russians, or released by WikiLeaks. Even if that's true, there's no federal crime. There's no federal law that prescribes that type of activity. It may look bad politically. We may want sunlight to be a good sanitizer on letting everyone know that that was going on, but it's not a crime.
It is about
judgment, though.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that there are a lot of questions here. Even if, you know, if this ends up being, Kushner ended up being an ancillary party in all of these discussions, or, you know, something happened that involved those meetings or gave Russians more insight into something and, you know, that wasn't his intention. There is a question here about the Trump campaign and the Trump administration's judgment and experience, and why was he meeting with these people? You know, why did Trump continue to have the contacts that he did? Why did Trump have that meeting in the Oval Office? There is a level of naivete here, at the very least, that is really troubling.
But that's what voters are thinking about. The FBI doesn't investigate bad judgment. The FBI doesn't investigate political wrongdoing. Special prosecutors don't look into bad judgment. They look into violations of federal law. And even if there was some sort of coordination, or that word that's been bandied about, collusion with the Russians, it's not a crime.
Okay, Kushner's, attorney has released a statement saying Mr. Kushner previously volunteered to share with Congress what he knows about these meetings. He will do the same if he is contacted in connection with any other inquiry. So, Dylan, to you, it appears that he's trying to be transparent, unlike General Flynn.
He is trying to be transparent. And look, the point is right, inexperience and naivete is not a federal crime. But it is true that it does create complications for the administration. It brings the investigation even closer to the president, just given how close Kushner is to the president. And again, the inexperience and whatever is being investigated by the FBI, those things are actually not unrelated, because the question is could you have taken steps? But let's say that Trump's campaign did nothing wrong. Let's say there was no collusion. Let's say this is all smoke without fire. Could the administration,
thing that Trump has done with the former FBI director Comey, so that, it adds to, the cloud over the White House.
It does, and it keeps each story that emerges like this brings the attention back to Trump and those meetings with Comey, the discussions with Comey, and the reports, the bombshells. Was it just this week? It seems like time is flying, right? But that he also. That he also asked other top officials to interfere in this investigation, and what was his intent? We still don't have answers to so many of these questions, and that's partly why some transparency would be nice here. So it's very encouraging that Kushner says that he's willing to talk to the FBI about whatever they want to know. We'll see if that happens.
There's, to that point, Trump and his administration can say, this is just a big media firestorm, nothing's wrong here, Jared Kushner hasn't done anything wrong, and indeed, so far, he hasn't done anything wrong that we know of. That said, the transparency issue is huge. There are greater steps that Trump and his administration could take to put this issue to bed, if indeed they believe this issue could be put to bed. That starts with, of course, the elephant that's always been in the room, or rather not been in the room, which is his tax returns.
Yeah.
Or the White House logs. We don't know
the White, exactly.
Who in his administration are meeting with. And having had all these questions about previous meetings, it just creates a lack of trust there that really may hurt them in 2018.
Dylan, May, Troy.
Thank you, Troy Slayton. Thanks so much for your analysis and expertise. Most appreciated.
Thanks all. Time for a quick break now. And many NATO leaders met President Trump for the first time Thursday, but he may not have given the ideal first impression. A remarkably awkward day in Brussels next.
Coming up to 10:33 here on the West Coast, we'd like to welcome back our viewers in the United States and around the world. I'm John Vores.
And I'm Aisha Sasay, live in Los Angeles. The breaking news from the U.S. state of Montana, where CNN projects Republican Greg Gianforte will win the race for the U.S. House of Representatives.
Right now, Gianforte is leading Democrat Rob Quist with 50.6% of the vote. Quist is on 43.6%. 87% of the vote has been counted. Gianforte was charged with misdemeanor assault for allegedly body slamming a reporter on Wednesday night, and he addressed that issue in the past hour.
Last night I made a mistake, and I took an action that I can't take back, and I'm not proud of what happened. I should not have responded in the way that I did, and for that I'm sorry.
And you're forgiven. Yeah.
Please. I should not have treated that reporter that way. And for that, I'm sorry, Mr. Ben Jacobs.
Well, apology to Ben Jacobs.
Yeah.
Let's see where this goes next.
It was very much an unexpected apology.
Yeah, it was indeed. We'll continue to follow events in Montana, but for the moment, let's turn our attention to the president. Donald Trump spent much of Thursday at a NATO summit in Brussels, and he suddenly made his presence known. First, it was appearing that he pushed the Montenegrin prime minister out of the way to take his place in the photo op.
Then there was the uncomfortably long handshake with the new French president, Emmanuel Macron. Finally, a scolding, chastising speech to NATO allies, much of which seemed to come straight from his campaign playbook.
NATO members must finally contribute their fair share and meet their financial obligations. But 23 of the 28 member nations are still not paying what they should be paying and what they are supposed to be paying for their defense. This is not fair to the people and taxpayers of the United States.
Well, former LA City Councilwoman Wendy Gruhl and Republican consultant Sean Phillips are back with us right now. Wendy, you saw the pictures.
I was
the scolding, the apparent shoving out of the way, the awkward handshake. What impression did the president create?
This was supposed to be a celebratory kind of event where they were getting together in unity of NATO. And I think if you had to grade him on how well he did on that message alone, I would say it was probably an F as to bringing unity together. It was shocking to me that you would push aside a prime minister like that. It is shocking to me that you would go to an event like this and chastise people and lecture them in a time where you're trying to bring people together. And I think that we'll probably see a Saturday Night Live skit that has all of that together soon.
John, you'd agree with Wendy?
Well, first of all, I'm not a Republican consultant. I do a show at KABC in Los Angeles. And
he's kind of a Republican.
He doesn't have a lot in common with these guys. So it's a getting to know you sort of meeting, because Trump pays his bills, unlike most of them. One of them rolled his eyes, and I don't think you have the right to roll your eyes if you're a deadbeat. So getting them to pay their bills is something that he ran on as during his campaign for the presidency. His audience was not those people. His audience was us back home.
But he has
and
to
we
work
want
with
them
those.
To pay their bill.
But he has to work with
I want them to pay their bill.
But if diplomacy is the art of getting people to do what you want, how does this get to that goal of getting there and berating and chastising and, you know, acting like, you know, the guy at a party no one wants to talk to?
If the public wants NATO to protect the West from Russian aggression, then getting these countries to pay their bill is the best way to do it.
Okay, but let's be clear. The agreement they made a couple of years ago was that these countries would pay about 2% of their GDP. Now, it's not that they're not paying anything.
They're not paying up to the 2%. Including, by the way, Germany. Germany sees themselves as being the big dog in Europe. They see themselves as being the adult in the room. They're not paying their bill. It's up to these countries to finally kick in and pay their fair share.
But to John's point, by going there and having this tone, aren't you ceding further ground to Angela Merkel? And furthermore, has the sense that she truly is now the leader of the free world. At least that's the view by many in Europe.
And it's the first time you're meeting some of these people. That's not, you know, that's not the kind of position that you want to take, which is to immediately lecture them and tell them they're deadbeats.
Let me argue the other side that I just said. This has been a concern for presidents in the in the U.S. for many, many years, that NATO is not putting up, and they have tried everything.
Uh-huh.
So why not give this a try? Why not try a little berating?
To me, this is not the time or place to do it. I think that, yes, you should have those conversations. You should say to them they've got to pay their fair share, but not that first meeting, not at a time in which you are there for a different purpose.
But if they're not doing it, then at what point do you kick it up a notch?
Yeah, I mean,
it's like your first date, you know? I could let go far on that. You know, certain things you just don't do on your first date.
The other problem that came out of this this summit, for want of a better word, every U.S. president since Harry Truman has endorsed Article 5, which is the collective defense clause, you know, an attack on one is an attack on all. Every president except Donald Trump. So, you know, John, again, you know, what is the message there that you're sending to the NATO allies? And keep in mind, the only time Article 5 has been invoked is after 9/11.
Right. Well, I mean, he ran as a Republican that was not a neocon pro-war hawk. He ran expressly against that point of view, against the Bush doctrine. He took it straight to Jeb's face at that debate in South Carolina. Are the American people willing to go to war over some military action in Montenegro? I don't think there's an appetite for that. But there's a political reality of having to come back to the United States and sell that to people. And look, I mean, I think NATO is a good force. I think NATO is a good thing. It certainly has helped the West out against Soviet aggression for many years. But I mean, that is a legitimate political question.
Let me push
you. They stood by us on
9/11. Yeah, I was about to say that.
They stood by us at a time that was
absolutely.
And so I think that that is a message he should have sent, and people were expecting it.
And John, I'm interested in your take here. If his base knew that, I mean, I'm sure a lot of them do, but if they truly understood that the only time Article 5, the clause, had been activated was for 9/11, wouldn't they have a different view of NATO?
Right, but the way that the rule works, if one of these countries that was formerly part of the Soviet bloc gets invaded by someone, then we're suddenly at war. I mean, you have to learn yes. some things from history. I mean, World War I started that way, and I just don't know if there's a public appetite to get involved in another world war over something like that.
So you believe NATO is, I mean...
I'm a supporter of NATO. And, but understanding the real political liabilities of being involved in a situation like that.
But Wendy, you have to take all of NATO. You can't pick and choose the bits
you like. No, you can't. And when you need them, they are there. And I think that is the important part that NATO serves for this world. And that you can't have them second guess figuring out is the United States going to be with us.
And John, why did he tell the French president that you're the one I supported? When clearly, come on.
Winning friend, right and left.
But on a serious note, will there be a fallout? Will there be a consequence to follow from the words he uttered there at the summit?
Well, I think there was an expectation that he was going to talk about Article 5 and support that. And so, once again, you see that he pushed aside. I mean, there's clearly what happened in pushing aside that prime minister and about some of the other ways in which he handled this at an event that was really supposed to talk about their unity. It didn't happen. And I think they're going to go back and say, some of the things we've read or heard about probably are true now. And we have got to be able to see how we're going to handle the United States of America with this president.
Sounds like a good place to take a break.
It does indeed.
Wendy and John, thank you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
So next year on Newsroom LA, new developments in the Manchester terror attack, what we know about the latest arrest in just a moment. Remain in custody.
This comes as the US and UK seem to be mending fences after sensitive information, including the name of the attacker, was leaked by the US. The UK says it will now resume sharing intelligence with the United States after briefly stopping those exchanges.
President Donald Trump slammed the disclosures and promised they would be investigated, and at the NATO meeting he condemned the Manchester attack. A U.S. official has told CNN it's likely that the bomber Salman Abedi received some ISIS training while visiting Syria several months ago, training which set the stage for Monday's attack. Just days before the bombing, Abedi returned to the U.K. from Libya. But that journey appears to have been via Germany, with officials there saying Abedi had traveled through Dusseldorf Airport. And a Turkish official says Abedi had recently transited through Istanbul's airport. CNN intelligence and security analyst and former CIA operative Bob Baer is with us now from Telluride. So Bob, firstly, what's the significance of Abedi's travel to Germany and Turkey in the days before the attack?
Well, the system, it was supposed to have been fixed, John, that we would find out who was crossing the border into Syria. The Turks were supposed to take care of this. But clearly there is a way across, which I think is very disturbing for everyone at this point, because you can get into Syria, you can get training, and you can come back to Europe and blow yourself up. We've been working with the Turks for the last couple of years. Apparently they can't seal their border.
So the only way really to get into ISIS-controlled territory in Syria is through Turkey. So if he made the journey and he got there, what sort of training would he likely have received?
Well, John, I look at the bomb. It's sophisticated for an IED. It had a circuit board. It had a very powerful battery. It probably had multiple detonators. Somebody who made this bomb, whether it was this 22-year-old or somebody else, knew what they were doing. They wanted this thing to go off. Also, you look at the positioning in Manchester, at the exit from the arena, maximum casualties, and enough explosives, and this is what you get. I mean, these people knew what they were doing. I also worry about the possibility that somebody wasn't standing far away and controlled with a radio-controlled device. We haven't seen evidence of that, but there's a possibility when you look at the sophistication of this bomb.
It also seems that the explosives used here, TATP, the same explosives used in the Brussels attack and also in the Paris attacks?
Acetone peroxide. And what they understand now is that you have to keep this stuff cool right up until the attack. It's very unstable. It's what we call blow in place. If the police find some of this stuff, they've got to blow it up rather than try to dismantle the explosive. This stuff could be all made locally in Manchester. It's just a matter of ventilation. Do it in the kitchen. You bring the peroxide up to 30% purity, acetone 100%, make a detonator out of the same stuff. Very easy to do, but you need practice. And this is where Syria comes in, because these people continue to make these bombs every day, all the time, and they're very good at it. And if you want to make sure a bomb goes off, you need to practice, and practice a lot. And Syria is the place to do it rather than Manchester.
Just very quickly, Abedi's sister has told the Wall Street Journal that he wanted revenge for children killed in the Syrian conflict, saying they were killed by American bombs. Does that ring true?
Oh, I think it is. They look at this conflict as an existential one. You kill us, we kill you. Of course, the fallacy of this, among many fallacies, is the British have absolutely nothing to do with the Syrian conflict. Yeah. They're barely in it. So, and taking, you know, revenge against civilians, against children, of course, makes no sense to us. But these people look at the world in apocalyptic terms, and it's sort of end times for them, and they think they need to strike back. And that's about the depth of this philosophy.
Okay, Bob, we'll leave it there. But thanks for being with us. Bob Baer, former CIA operative. Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
Let's take a quick break now, and we'll get a check of the numbers in Montana's special election, where the projected winner is also facing assault charges. A late apology next on Newsroom LA. Hello, everyone. We're learning more about the almost two dozen people killed in the Manchester attack. Elaine MacIver was a police officer who was off duty during Monday's concert. Her family says she was a huge music fan, thoughtful and absolutely fearless.
19-year-old Courtney Boyle was also killed along with her stepfather, Philip Tron. Boyle's mother called them both her angels flying high in the sky. And Sorrel Laskowski was just 14 years old. Her grandfather says he's absolutely heartbroken. Laskowski wanted to become an architect to build her mother a house.
Well, for a list of ways you can help those affected by the terror attack in Manchester, go to cnn.com/impact. There you can also help with investigation by uploading photos or videos of the scene for the Manchester police. That's at cnn.com/impact.
Finish this hour with a very quick update on the breaking news. CNN projecting Montana Republican Greg Gianforte will win the special election for the U.S. House of Representatives.
Now, the latest numbers show Gianforte with 50.6% of the vote. Democrat Rob Quist has 43.6%. 87% of the vote has been counted.
The victory comes just a day after police charged Gianforte with misdemeanor assault for allegedly body slamming a reporter. He apologized for that during his victory speech. You've been watching CNN Newsroom live from Los Angeles. I'm John Bors.
And I'm Aisha Sasse. We'll be back with much more news right after this.